Katie here with the Third String Morning Show, and in the studio with me right now is Lacey Sturm. You may recognize her from the band Flyleaf from years ago, but you've been doing your own solo thing for a while now. You have the new album, Life Screams, is out. It's been out since February. Going crazy with it.
Yeah.
How's it feel?
Well, it's a big whirlwind for sure. I mean, the first few months of us getting into this, things were just, they felt so free and easy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because it was just us doing what we love, and it was at our own pace. And then we got on tour, and we had an amazing tour, like just with family. Mm-hmm. That was a big thing. I was nervous about coming in on the road with my kids and figuring out how to balance everything. And it just seemed to fall in place. And then recently, I wish Josh had a microphone. Josh, my husband's here. But recently in the past, month, I guess, my husband and I have started like trying to figure out more, as more things come on mm-hmm. to our schedule. And we're starting to try to like find where we're breaking down here and there and what to do about it. So I think that this tour has been, this past couple of weeks has been really sort of raw.
Okay.
And it's a good place because it's really real and honest, but at the same time, it's not what it was like a couple months ago when there was just such a bunch of we still laugh a lot, but it's
harder.
It's more like laughing at the ridiculousness
right.
instead of, what I mean?
It's got to be crazy to balance mm-hmm. life on the road and family. And especially as the album grows and the tour grows and you continue to grow,
well,
more people begging for you.
What's talking about this is that I got signed with publishers for 3 books.
Mm-hmm.
So I wrote The Reason mm-hmm. about my story, having, overcome suicide and an encounter with God and changing my life from an atheist who hated people, hated God. And then my next book's going to come out in October. It's called The Mystery.
I like when people answer questions before I ask questions. It's so perfect.
Well, I'm just saying, because we're talking about the balance. So the third book, I already have been thinking about it since I started writing.
Right.
I'm not sure what the title is, but in my head, it's like, it's about stewarding your gifts and mm-hmm. everything that you've been given,
mm-hmm.
like your relationships, your heart, your soul. Soul growing is so important,
mm-hmm.
and never stop seeking growth in your heart and as a person, and how do you steward like just simple things like your relationship with your kids, your relationship with your husband, and then your relationship to the earth. Like how do you make choices with your money and the gifts you've been given, like the talents you have, like you must be a great communicator or you wouldn't mm-hmm. be having this interview. That's a gift.
Right.
What I mean? Not
right.
everybody has that. So, and then what was his name again?
Kyle.
Kyle has a great gift with technology and engineering and things like that. I could never do that.
Right.
So,
oh, my goodness.
So how do you steward that gift while you're here to make the world a better place somehow, mm-hmm. And so I think the key is balancing, which you just asked me about. It's like,
right.
how do we put our priorities in the right place and find our identity in the right place, and not in what we do, but in who we are. We're not human doings, we're human beings.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So like, what does that look like? And so that's what I'm in the process of writing this third book.
Okay.
And it's being challenged so much. Like, you believe these things? Well, let's live them out and see how well you do in this situation. And
has it been giving you some new lessons for some different chapters in the book?
Always. Even still, with The Reason, there's still things I'm learning
right.
about, depression and about suicide and about how, when I'm good and I feel whole and I feel like it's a good day,
mm-hmm.
I feel like I can do so much. Like, my capacity is huge.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm not good, I can't even change out of my PJs.
Yep.
I can't, you know what I'm saying? So it's been I'm always open to keep learning about the things that I feel like I got my feet under me.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it's like a stair step. And so there's so many steps to get to the top of this like there's so many like ladder, like I don't know how to explain it. Like you're climbing up a ladder to get to this next step.
Right.
And then once you get there, you're at zero again. Mm-hmm. And like right before that, you thought you knew everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get to that flat platform and you're like, oh my gosh, I don't know anything.
It's funny. One of my good friends in radio told me years ago, because I was kind of going in that thing. You're like climbing and climbing and climbing and climbing and climbing. And you're like, I'm just trying to get to that top and I'm exhausted. I'm working so hard. There's so much going on. I feel like I'm going to break down and just explode right now. And he looked at me and he was like, Katie, you know, sometimes when we're on a mountain, here's the mountain and you started here and then you get up here and you're so focused on looking forward that you're not looking down at all this other stuff that you climbed.
Yes, exactly.
Take that moment. Look down
Take
at what
the
you've
moment.
Climbed. Be proud.
Be thankful.
Be proud.
Yes.
Like, look what you've accomplished in this last year. You released a new album. You have been on tour all over the place and figured out how to balance home life on the road. How many people can say they've even attempted to do that, let alone do it? And you're writing another book. You've got another book coming out, you said, in October. The Mystery is coming out in October.
Yes.
I'd say you've accomplished a lot in this year.
Thank you,
It makes
Josh.
Sense that there's some
Josh is
crazy.
Congratulating me over here, and I'm thanking him because it really has to do with his steering the ship a lot.
I think it's good that you've found someone who obviously inspires you and lets you do your thing.
Well, that's really his vision and his heart is to pull out all the good things in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
And so it helps that if that's his goal, that we get to accomplish a lot. Because
how did you guys meet?
Do you want
to? He's like, I don't want to tell this story.
Don't give me a microphone. he was in a band called Kairos. We mentioned he was touring with his brother, and they opened up for us. We came through Pennsylvania, Pittsburgh, and he became friends with my guitar player.
Okay.
We never met really in that first time. Well, he says we met at some point, but I don't remember.
He's like, thanks, babe. Thanks. I remember you. You don't remember me.
But then the next time we met, we talked and we hit it off really well. And we talked about tattoos and Pantera and Jesus, and it was awesome.
It's just kind of been a whirlwind ever since. So how is it, because, I mean, you're so open in your experiences in life. You're so open with your testimonial and talking about how you were an atheist and then were going to commit suicide and then found Christianity and the argument with your grandmother and just everything. You're so open about it. How does that affect you when you're out and you're on tour and people are coming up to you and they're talking to you and they're, I'm assuming, asking some really personal questions?
Yeah.
How do you handle that? How does that affect what you're doing?
Well, I think it really helps to, as far as like getting interviews and being in front of everybody and and just letting them think what they're going to think no matter what you say, because you can't, they're going to interpret it through their own experience, you know? But all you can do is be yourself, but at the same time, hang on to the principles that are important to you. So, like, say what I want to communicate, my main message is love. I mean, that's my main message. And so if people start getting into these areas where it's getting off focus for me, I can always remember, hey, you know what? The point of all of this is this love that transformed my life. And so I can pull it back and still be guarded enough to where I don't open myself up to things that are going to set it all up to get distracted on some, you know, because I think that's what happens a lot with faith and the mainstream, is that people get caught up in things that, you know, there are things that are controversial about what we believe in. You know, there are things, you know, we believe that, you know, things that are controversial, and people would start fighting over it. And so I have to ask myself, is my point, there are people out there whose point is to highlight those controversies and share why they think that they're important. Like, there's a guy named Ravi Zacharias. He was an atheist who's going to commit suicide. He's an Indian. He grew up in India. He was in a Hindu and Muslim culture, like all kinds of different religions, whatever. And you could get killed if you were Christian.
Yeah.
And so, like, very controversial to change your faith. And for him at 16, ready to die for lack of purpose and having an encounter with God himself. And I met him the other day. I was like, oh my God, I love you. Because like when I first became a Christian, I was, like I said, I was an atheist, hated Christians. They never could answer my questions. Mm-hmm. So I really got into like stories about atheists who become Christians, mm-hmm. and saw how they processed their, you know, whatever. And so like his job is to go in front of like colleges where people hate Christians and answer questions that they have. Like he loves that.
That's amazing.
He's supercharged by that. And he does it with such tact and class, like class and kindness, and he does it so intelligently. And so like if that was my job, then I think I would have the grace to be able to do that. Mm-hmm. But my job isn't to do that right now. Maybe one day when I learn a lot more.
You do it in a way. You just do it a little different. You do it through music.
But mine is, it's through music. It's through telling my own story, mm-hmm. and through just be myself and really focusing in on the love that I encountered and how that changed my perspective towards humans. You know, like any human, like all it means to be a Christian is to admit that you need a savior.
You need help.
And it doesn't mean I'm better than anybody.
Right.
And even though that's what it seems like so often when you watch people talk in public, it just means I need a savior. I'm screwed up and I experienced this and it's for anyone, you know? So it should be make you loving.
Okay.
I don't know.
I think that's awesome. I appreciate the fact that you're very open in talking about it and very vulnerable about it, but you never try to push anything on anybody. You seem to just, I'm going to answer the questions and this is how I am and love me or hate me. I don't really care. That's awesome. Yeah. Appreciate that.
Well, I think everybody has their process. Mm-hmm. I mean, I couldn't save myself. How could I save other people? You know what I mean? True. So, everybody has their timing and all that. So I'm not worried about it. I mean, I do have a weight sometimes, you know, like people you love and you see their life, like them, you can see that they're making destructive choices for themselves, mm-hmm. and you want to like go fix them. And I think that's this season of, and I talk about that in the mystery, how I made destructive choices for myself and thought I was following God, mm-hmm. and I was in an emotional affair and I was like, and I was thinking justifying it because we weren't sleeping together. But at the mm-hmm. same time, it was probably even worse to me. Mm-hmm. And I justified it. I made these destructive choices. And then I had this person in my life who was like a pastor. He was like a father figure, sort mm-hmm. of. And he was like telling me the right thing, but he wasn't forcing me he would never cross my will. He always asked me questions so I can make my own decisions. Mm-hmm. And when I did the wrong thing, or the destructive thing is what I should say, he was grieved, but he still had hope that mm-hmm. God's God and he's not, and he's going to take care of me. And, you know, I talk about this. I did a TED Talks not that long ago. Mm-hmm. And I talk a little bit about how I learned that love honors your freedom in that situation, mm-hmm. instead of trying to control you mm-hmm. and make you do what they want you to do. And that was the most life-changing thing to me. And I really try to hang on to that mm-hmm. in my life. Just honor the freedom of people and how without freedom, we can't understand what love is because we can't know our choices are genuine.
Right.
You know what I mean?
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Makes a lot of sense. I'm curious for this book that's coming out in October. What with the mystery, when you were sitting down to write it and put it together, what was kind of in the back of your head and like, this is what I want to focus on and concentrate on?
Oh, there were so many things. The process was so hard. Poor Josh, you know, watching me. Poor. I didn't really see him close.
I love how he's
like, thank eyes, God, the in. Book is done.
This crazy woman, I'm done.
You know, and I'm reading him all kinds of things. And this is in the middle. Like, I'm talking about having an affair and I'm having to go back and relive these intense, like, romantic moments in my head of, like, my heart being totally deceived and given away. And he's like, you know, just like, the first half of the book, same with The Reason, is very heavy. Mm-hmm. And then the second part is so light. I mean, I talk about meeting him and how, you know, great our experience was in contrast.
Right.
You know? If I had read that first half of the book first and uh-huh. I had been me and my old self, I'd be like, this is not real. These people are not real. Like, this is so unrealistic. But when you read the first part, you realize, oh, this is why she, like, she doesn't know right from wrong sometimes. She needs help, you know? So no wonder she's like making it so strict and so straight,
right?
You know, like, it's the narrow. It wasn't, you know, I don't know. I made it a lot more strict than I think anybody would have expected, because I was like, I almost died. I mean, in that book, I talk about being suicidal again. Mm-hmm. And I got a letter from a fan.
So you experienced it again, even after.
Oh, I always, okay. I always had, you know, this looming temptation of ending my life. Mm-hmm. And it was always sort of with me, around me. I mean, I'm going out talking to kids to deal with it. And you just, when you have a gift to feel what other people feel, sometimes
soak
it
in.
It's not even your own feeling. It's mm-hmm. just you have empathy, so that you start to think the reasonableness of wanting to end your life.
Mm-hmm.
And then outside of it, it doesn't seem reasonable at all. But in the midst of it, it's just like you can't see anything else. And so in the book, I talk about struggling in a really, like, I was closer in that book than I was in the first one. I was closer to taking my life. And you know, I got a letter from a fan the other day, and she said she heard an interview I did with Ryan Reese from the Whosoevers.
Oh, love the Whosoevers.
Oh, you
did. I was wearing an Islander shirt yesterday.
I
love the Whosoevers.
Off my Whosoever shirt. I was like, oh, we're,
they're awesome. Shirt. Wonderful
but,
cause.
But I was doing an interview with them. I was talking about this, about how I got an opportunity to do, or they were asking me about doing a song for the Twilight movie or whatever back when it when I was in Flyleaf mm-hmm. and it first came out. And I was like, well, I don't know. I got to read it. So I start reading the books, and I did not like it.
Really?
I did not like it.
I refused to pick them up.
Well, the reason I didn't like it is because it was everything that brought me to that place of suicide,
mm-hmm.
that my whole identity is wrapped up in this romance. I don't have any identity outside of that.
Right.
And so when the romance is over, I don't want to live anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And the girl, even in the main character, wants to die mm-hmm. in the book, because her boyfriend doesn't, or this guy she loves does not want to be with her. And her only reason for not is because she would hurt her parents. And I was like, well, what if your parents, like, you don't care about hurting your parents? Like,
right.
What if you don't have that relationship? Like, and I'm like, I thought about my own self reading that and how it would justify my own thoughts
mm-hmm.
of suicide over a romance. And this girl is writing me this letter thanking me for what I said in the interview, because she said, I thought I was just a silly girl and I didn't want to admit that I was suicidal over a romantic relationship. She said, it was so good to hear you say that you mm-hmm. went through that too. And I was so thankful to hear. I'm going to cry because I really want people to know the seriousness of, you know, just putting your whole heart and life into a person
mm-hmm.
that is just human, you know, my message is, you know, if you expect God to be God for you, if you expect someone else, like a human, to be a God for you, they're going to end up being human.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to need forgiveness, and they're going to fail, and things will change. And some people, you know, like I say this every night at our concerts, You're Not Alone is about a loved one that died. And she was wanting her loved ones to know they weren't going to be alone, and that it was a weight on her because she felt responsible for them. And the only God who's God enough to be God for you is God himself.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really where the only place I could find peace, because we all, you know, whenever I make anything out to be a God and it turns out not to be God, my whole world crashes.
Yeah.
And I don't know why I'm living anymore. But if, you know, if I find my wholeness in the fact that, you know what, I have a breath, it's a gift for a reason, and I might not see it, but I can trust that there is a good reason.
Mm.
So I'm going to keep breathing, you know, because there's some reason why I'm different from everyone else in the world, that I have a different DNA.
Mm.
I have a different perspective. I have a different voice. And there's something that I can do in the world that no one else can do. Even if it's just one little ripple, it's going to go out, and who knows what mm-hmm. it'll impact. And that's true for every single breath of life in every human.
Mm-hmm.
I think we can use our freedom to do destruction, great destruction. And at the same time, on the opposite side, we can use our freedom to do great, amazing, glorious things, you know. And if we can look into the face of the troubles we have and overcome them, and all of a sudden, that's like this like forest fire in others, we can overcome too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can overcome too. I saw this, and that's kind of the impossible song, is like, it says, when when I'm weak, I wonder if it's going to be all right. But too many times I've seen this all come to life, you know, so I've seen the dead come to life over and over. And so then I know, I, you know, well, I'm watching for that.
Well, I'm glad that you found your voice and are so open and are not ashamed of any of the struggles that you've been through, and really put that out there, because I think that you've definitely changed some people's worlds. And if like you said, if you help one person, butterfly in Africa can cause a hurricane somewhere else.
I believe in that.
If you affect one person, that's really all that matters. That person could make the difference in the world.
You never know. And there's so many historical, there's so many people that have done that. Just one person influenced one person, and that person, you know, was Abraham Lincoln or whatever. I don't know.
Good town to use that one in. The home of Lincoln. I like it. Well, let's have you do a song today. Do we know what we're going to do? I know you guys were debating back and forth beforehand. Josh is leaving it to you. He's like, woman. I'm going to make you make this choice.
Well, it's in between you. It's up to you. I'll let you choose. What do you
think? His choice is, it's like asking somebody what they want for dinner. Where do you want to eat, honey? Well, we can eat here.
Okay, we'll do it. What was it, Run to You? Oh, sorry. This is Run to You, and it's again about that theme of how love honors your freedom. You tell me I'm the one holding you. Something about how far we're off track. But all I hear is your heartbeat loud and strong. And I just want to wrap you in my arms. But I'll let you go if that's what you want. But I hope you know my love. And you call me a fool, but call out my name, I'll run to you. I know you, I know your eyes so well. And I know you're not sure of yourself. Something made you restless years ago. Till you forgot that I'm part of your soul. But I'll let you go if that's what you want. But I hope you know my love won't stop. You say it's not true. And you call me a fool, but call out my name, I'll run to you. I've always believed in you. You used to believe in me too. Remember the day that you turned away. It killed me to lose you. It killed me to lose you. But I'll let you go if that's what you want. But I hope you know my love won't stop. You say it's not true. And you call me a fool, but call out my name, I'll run to you. I'll run to you, I'll run to you. I've always believed in you. I'll run to you, I'll run to you. And 'cause I love you, I'll let you go if that's what you want. But I hope you know my love won't stop.
Wow, that was incredible. Your voice, I could listen to you all day long. That was awesome. Thank you so much. Thanks for coming in and talking and joining our Facebook live stream. And it's awesome. I got goosebumps. You gave me goosebumps. What are you doing to me? This is not fair. Yeah. Oh, man. Well, thank you so much. Appreciate it. We'll let you guys get back on the road and head on out to the next city. Where are you playing tonight?
Berwyn, Illinois.
I don't even know where.
Chicago.
Berwyn. Okay. All right. I'll take that. You were in St. Louis last night. Berwyn tonight. That's awesome. Thank you for listening. It's Lacey Sturm. Get the new album, Life Screams. It is in stores. You're listening to 97.7 QLZ.